future. I gotta check this out.
Shouldn't have gone too far. I went too far, man.
Yeah.
Never go too far. Future really messed him up.
Is he gonna be okay?
It's probably just dehydration. That's a side effect of time travel. Here you go. Ah!
Cardiac arrest.
You know he's more of a Pepsi man, right?
No! No, I didn't know that!
Your attention, please. The following is a sub-ether transmission from the year 2015.
2015 brought a lot of much-needed changes to the park, which was fitting since they were celebrating their 50th anniversary a year after their actual 50th anniversary, all because that other park was celebrating their 60th. Then again, they had their decorations up for almost 2 years, and I spent more than that counting down my favorite attractions, so I don't think it would be too hypocritical of a park that housed rides based on time travel movies to wait a year to throw a little party.
Just let us do something nice for once!
So as I mentioned in the last episode, to add to the spectacle, the general aesthetic changed to match the super classy Golden Age Hollywood feel of the plaza, leading to a brand new archway at the top of the Starway, and an even more gorgeous entry area for the studio tour. In fact, because it was the park's 51st anniversary, the tour got the most love of all. First came a new style of trams, which didn't change too much from the 2000s design, outside of a new color scheme and mercifully more comfortable seat cushions. The queue got some new artwork celebrating landmark films Universal has made over the years, and the video loops began to show classic adverts for the park. Meaning... It's just as beautiful as the first time. But probably the most interesting development with the tour in 2015 was a shiny new attraction, which we'll get to later. But to ensure everyone had the chance to experience it, they extended tram operating hours by offering seasonal nighttime tours. See, back in the days of yore, the tour closed at sundown because the only lighting on the lot was meant for productions, and touring the back lot without lights is like driving through a post-apocalyptic hellscape.
Wow, that line became relevant.
So they threw up a few LEDs, altered the script to include mention of production lighting, which is much appreciated, and introduced Marilyn Monroe and Frankenstein's monster to the roster of stops, as well as video effects in the windows of Six Points Texas and the mobile lab from The Lost World. Other than that, it's not too different from the normal tour, just darker. Not many of the attractions are enhanced by the night, with the extreme exception of the Flood and Jaws. Just wow. Overall, it's a cool new way. Really? I thought I just ate. I'll get something later. It's a cool new way to experience such a historic attraction while giving guests a reason to stick around a little longer. Hence, a bunch more additions around the park. On the lower lot, the Raptor Encounter meet and greet was installed next to JP to promote Jurassic World memes, probably. It's functionally similar to the Transformers, but it's still amazing in its own right. Not as much as Megatron, though. He is precious and must be protected no matter what language he speaks. But that leads to a point in the Raptor's favor. Meeting the Autobots? No problem. Optimus and Bumblebee are just recruiting you to help them defeat evil. Megatron, though? Well, as much as I love how sassy he can get...
Starscream, target the man in the kaleidoscope shirt. Destroy his YouTube channel. He's begging for content.
I was wearing this for context. It's still freaking Megatron! And there's no way, in universe, human soldiers would stand idly by while the leader of a hostile alien robot race takes pictures with civilians, let alone encourage them to do so! Oh, you traitors! However, you have not Chris Pratt standing between you and a resurrected 6-foot turkey as you pose for the pictures. So this one makes more sense. What doesn't make sense is what they added to the upper lot. See, Shrek's queue got a much more impressive enhancement than the attraction deserved. Yes, it looks pretty, giving off that enchanted forest vibe. can't imagine why, but that was the only thing that changed. The theater's facade still looked the same, and yeah, they built a space for another Uncanny Valley donkey puppet to pop out of in the pre-show area, but the rest of it remained untouched, least of which was the film itself, opinions of which have shifted since the last time, in case you couldn't tell. Admittedly, it does have its moments of genuine excitement, but in a post-enchanted, tangled, frozen world, Shrek's pessimistic subversion of Disney fairy tales became immensely shallow. And to have an attraction in a theme park for as long as it existed... So that just made the queue enhancement all the more confusing. Like, okay, imagine if Superstar Limo never closed.
Stay with me.
But they remodeled the facade and queue to look like the Great Movie Ride. Maybe this change was because of its proximity to what would open in 2016. And yes, it would end up being replaced in 2018 by the much more opulent DreamWorks Theater and Kung Fu Panda Adventure. But during an
epic transformation,
changing everything but the attraction seems a bit short-sighted. Then there's the issue of making it available on every platform known to man, and...
Oh, you've given me a much prettier environment to watch this on my phone. But I'm officially hangry now, so we'll hit the pause button on this retrospective so we can get some grub.
But where? Mel's? Not really in the mood for a gas station burger. Lab cafe? No, the quality dipped way down after the first few months. Three Broomsticks? Doesn't exist right now. Well, hang on. What? Is this? Following the Minions example, The Simpsons was the next IP to receive its own themed area in the form of the town the titular family calls home. However, unlike its Floridian counterpart, Springfield doesn't include any new rides. Arguably, the storefronts are the attractions, but more so the new food offerings. Well, new. The first comes from Phineas Cube Butterfats and Luigi's. Ice cream and pizza. Really not much has changed since these were Ben and Jerry's and Louie's. Then there's Suds McDuff's Hot Dogs, the Duff Brewery Beer Garden, and Bumblebee Man's Taco Truck. Again, all pretty self-explanatory, but nothing quite as unique as The Simpsons deserve. Unless you look across the street. Lard Lad, Krusty Burger, Moe's Tavern, and Cletus's Chicken Shack make up the rest of Springfield, and they're all located under the same two-storied roof, bookended with facades of places it would be pretty interesting to browse around. Yeah, Android's Dungeon is still a facade, though somewhat more functional than when it was on the side of the Quickie Mart. Even the dining areas are well decorated, including monitors running restaurant-related highlights from the show. But this being Universal, they couldn't help but include this little gem. That would come back to bite him. Anyway, Lard Lad Donuts serves those giant head-size monstrosities, only now they're made fresh in the park. Krusty Burger has...
steamed hams. That's what I call hamburgers.
You call hamburgers steamed hams?
Yes.
Well, whatever they're called. These are charbroiled to delicious perfection, and the menu features three other items from the show. The Mother Nature Burger, the Rib Witch...
Now without lettuce.
And...
the Clogger. If you can find a greasier sandwich, you're in Mexico!
You know this was a joke, right? Or were they too preoccupied with whether they could? They'd never stop to think if they should. Looks good, though. Too bad I can't have it. Moving on, Moe's Tavern is an honest-to-God bar filled to the brim with the most loving nods to the show. And where you can get, yes, a flaming Moe. Or something actually alcoholic, if you are so inclined. And then there's Cletus's Chicken Shack, which brought fried chicken back into the park! It's okay. But not everywhere can be not, which is why they introduced the Chicken and Waffles Sandwich. Fried chicken breast smothered with maple syrup aioli, nestled between two delectably sweet waffles. It honestly has no right to be as good as it is, and it's hands down my favorite dish in Springfield. But let's take a moment to recap these offerings. We have hot dogs, pizza, tacos, burgers, chicken. Some variety, but when compared to the rest of the park,
you'll start to notice it doesn't extend much further than that. Sure, there are some unique items here and there, and they would end up expanding their offerings the next year, which we'll get to later, but nothing strays too far from your average state fair vendor. Heck, Jurassic Cafe outright prides itself in serving burgers and chicken. And at one point, pizza, but eh. However, Springfield does have some of the best food in the park, but even then, that's not a high bar to get over. I know, I'm at a theme park. I shouldn't expect high-quality fine dining or even a close facsimile. To which I argue, Blue Bayou at Disneyland and Mrs. Knott's Chicken Dinner. On the one end of the spectrum, the Blue Bayou is Disneyland's premier restaurant, and yes,
that's a little pricey, but you know what, it's worth it.
And on the other, we have a restaurant that's been around since the 30s, hasn't changed a single recipe since then, all while ending up being owned by Cedar Fair. Yes, the Cedar Fair. Six Flags' bizarro cousin has a better restaurant than all of Universal's combined. Not only that, but both of them are table service restaurants, whereas literally all of Universal's are quick service. Even Magic Mountain has a table service restaurant! It's not good, but there are certainly worse options in the park. Again, I know I shouldn't expect a lot from a theme park, but having exclusively quick service restaurants gives off a bad vibe. Like they care more about guest throughput than guest service. Well, maybe I don't want to feel like I'm being rushed to the next ride. Maybe I want to sit down for a while and have my order taken from a table. Maybe I want my food to be prepared and brought out in a reasonably timely manner. Maybe I want to tip the waiter. Maybe...
rage-induced heartburn. Ugh. Yeah, I'm definitely gonna need more.
Maybe I've been spoiled by Disney and Knott's, but I don't think putting forth a little more effort in this area is too much to ask. Especially if they are competing with the mouse to build the best, most fully immersed experiences for guests. But I'm not going to let this criticism stand on its own. I'm going to offer suggestions. Springfield is fine. Everything there is good. Maybe just boost the quality of the chicken fry and go back to the thicker burger patties, but that's about it. Mel's, better milkshakes. It's a diner, for God's sake. Gru's Lab, bring back the logo grill marks on the pulled pork grilled cheese and maybe add a few more banana-related items, or change the theme entirely, that works too. Jurassic Cafe, tear it all down and start from scratch. Offer some Costa Rican and island-inspired dishes. Make this feel exotic. Oh good, you read my mind. Although, you might want to dial it back on this Jurassic World promotion, though. It's getting a little out of hand. I mean, what are you going to do next? Change the ride to match the movie?
You have got to be kidding me!
As for Panda, really the biggest crime was not incorporating it into Transformers, making it the Nestrant.
And what would they serve?
We serve hearty meat and potato type meals here. Things like meatloaf, spaghetti and meatballs, and delicious cream chipped beef.
Someone in this company was paid to write that, and they didn't make it a reality. It doesn't make any sense.
Getting back to Springfield, it feels inconsistent. A lot of care and attention was most certainly paid to the new structures, but the Quickie Mart remained virtually untouched, complete with cardboard cutouts of the characters that I never cared for to begin with, in close proximity to the character meet and greet areas. But with the new facades came fully rendered 3D static figures of a few characters, which grew over the years to even more 3D static figures, including ones that already had a 3D static figure in the area.
That's the joke.
But is it though?
I've come to despise this excuse in my long years as a denizen of the internet, but with regard to The Simpsons,
cartoons don't have to be 100% realistic.
The show was founded on the basis of mocking everyday norms and all that was sacred in pop culture, not the least of which were theme parks and how they sell you brief feelings of nostalgia and brushes with death for ever-increasing prices, with little to no effort put forth on their end. The culmination being the very ride that is the crux of this land, which, yes, I criticize for being inconsistent as well. I don't like how everything in the queue looks so cheap, or how the characters are represented with 2D animation on the monitors, but 3D animation in the ride film. But...
that's the joke.
If you walk into the ride with the mindset that this is all the work of a corner-cutting cheapskate of a clown, then writing off the real-world lazy creative decisions that were made is a pretty good joke. For 2008. For better or worse, Potter changed the rules for what a theme park area can be, and as the transformations were happening all around the park for its arrival, well, if immersion was the goal, this ain't it, Chief. I don't feel like this is a living, breathing town in the same way as Hogsmeade. The food and the facades were a good start, but it's too dense, there's way too much emphasis on eateries, but they literally jumped the shark with these statues. No, I'm serious. Part of what is now Springfield used to be where the iconic hanging Jaws prop used to be alright, focus, statues. They're great photo ops, sure, but during peak seasons or freakishly busy days, it makes an already congested area even more cramped. What with everybody stopping to take pictures with... topiary bottle people? I mean, isn't the whole idea of the ride that everyone in town is at Krustyland? So wouldn't it be funnier if it looked like everyone had dropped what they were doing just to check out the new ride? Because as it is now, the way they're all frozen doesn't make me feel immersed. It gives me the creeps.
Unless...
don't move! Can't see us if we don't move.
Well, no need to keep ignoring... that. Disney's acquisition of 21st Century Fox was finalized in March of 2019, which means they now own The Simpsons. Now, for the TV side of things, that means all of nothing. It's still going to air in syndication, and it's renewed 2 seasons. After that, who knows? But the theme park side of things are a little trickier. Universal acquired the rights in 2007. However, unlike the deal they struck with Marvel, it's not in perpetuity, with rumors suggesting that it was a limited agreement with an end date of 2028. But now that Disney is holding the deed, all of that is carried over, and so far, nothing's been announced, but there's hearsay that Disney might want to use The Simpsons as a bargaining chip to gain the Marvel rights for use in their Florida parks. While that remains to be seen, my theory is... Universal's gonna ditch it entirely. Just mere weeks after Disney initially purchased Marvel, all traces of their characters were removed from the Hollywood park. Granted, they didn't have much of a presence at the time, outside of Storm, Spidey, Cap, and Wolverine riding their ATVs, a Hulk statue, and the gift shop. Concerning this situation, a turnaround at this scale wouldn't be impossible, it would just be tough to pull off. But I'd be willing to bet that Creative is planning something. Maybe not anything that uses this ride system, because let's just say she's getting on in years. And before you say, we'll just bring back to the Future.
No.
So it would have to be a new ride with a new ride system based on a new IP. But again, the Simpsons ride and Springfield are safe. For now. But is this a joke? Possibly, but that's also its biggest failing. Yes, the show did lay the foundation for all comedy that has followed, and if you squint, this can be seen as Universal paying homage to that legacy.
Kinda wish they'd do that with things they actually own.
But the Simpsons are at their funniest in the tiniest details. Most of the Easter eggs strewn throughout the area nail this down pat. And as much as I can't find myself to like it, so does the ride. I mean, it's basically an overblown episode of the show where you just happen to be a passive participant. However, placing statues of lovable characters in, let's face it, highly inconvenient locations doesn't have the same effect, especially when the very design of the area doesn't promote exploration as much as a way to get to other parts of the park. So among the grandiose picture that is the evolution plan, Springfield, while having good food and half-decent atmosphere, feels like an afterthought.
Well, that's disappointing. Good thing I know how to turn this around. The studio tour's brand new attraction and grand finale,
Fast and Furious Super Chew. Ah! What the hell? Stupid cord.
Charlie.
Honey? Honey, was that? Cassie? Guys? Guys, this isn't funny. Guys? Guys!
Okay. I know I'm about to discuss something I don't like. Get this over with and show yourself.
Inappropriate tonal shift. Ooh.
And this video is partially sponsored by my patrons over on Patreon, whose names you are seeing scroll by right now. For as little as a dollar a month, you can do just that and support the channel.
And see your own name scroll by on screen and read aloud by me if you are a newcomer. And there were certainly a lot of you recently. And they are. Do you want to read the patrons?
Swizzly Bubbles, Trevor Gumble, Michael Nelson, and Jurassic Samurai. However, if you want to get a little crazier and join the Cool Cats Club, allowing me to bring Bailey on screen, you may join the ranks of Christopher, Danielle Garcia, Dylan Van Voren, Jerry Callahan, Kevin J. Gabriel, Maverick Myries, Morgan L.F., Pander Plays, and Tony Goldmark. Again, any amount will do. You can cancel any time. And during these weird times, don't feel obligated to do so. Anyway, I will be hard at work on the next iteration of this to the best of my ability. So as always, like, share, subscribe, all that good stuff. Stay safe, stay healthy. Black Lives Matter. Bonus nachos, kids.